TAG TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening, welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Uzma Jafri. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Friday, the 6th of March. Government steps up measures as coronavirus cases in India rise to 31. Afghan political leader Abdullah escapes attack on Kabul ceremony, 27 killed. And female boxing coach challenges barriers in conservative Pakistan. And now for all the details. A person in Indian capital New Delhi with a travel history to Thailand and Malaysia was tested positive for coronavirus, taking the total number of confirmed cases in India to 31 on Friday. The Indian government has made universal screening mandatory for all international passengers arriving in India.
The number of novel coronavirus or COVID-19 cases in India rose to 31 on Friday as a New Delhi resident tested positive. The patient, who has a recent travel history to Thailand and Malaysia, is being monitored, a health ministry official said. In response to the increasing number of cases, India's health ministry has started universal screening at all airports for all passengers coming to India from any country. India has suspended visas of travelers coming from coronavirus-hit countries like Italy, Iran, South Korea, Japan, and China. Passengers from Italy and South Korea will have to carry no COVID-19 certificate before entering India from March 10th. The Health Ministry, in coordination with provincial governments, has set up isolation wards across the country and is regularly reviewing the situation.
Pura apne desh ke sabhi state governments ko activate kiya hua hai, DM level tak logon ko activate kiya hua hai, and hamara jo integrated disease surveillance ka jo mechanism hai usko puri tarah se activate kiya hua hai. Lagatar iski monitoring Pradhanmantri ji ke level pe ho rahi hai.
Meanwhile, neighbouring Bhutan's Prime Minister also confirmed the first positive case of COVID-19 in the country on Friday. The patient is a 76-year-old tourist from US, a press release said. The COVID-19 outbreak, which originated in China, has infected more than 96,000 people across the globe. It has claimed more than 3,200 lives so far.
In news from Afghanistan, at least 27 people were killed and 29 wounded as gunmen attacked a ceremony in Afghan capital Kabul on Friday, where a top political leader, Abdullah Abdullah, was present but escaped unharmed. The Taliban said in a statement they were not involved in the attack.
Gunmen attacked a ceremony in the Afghan capital Kabul on Friday, where a top Afghan political leader, Abdullah Abdullah, was present but escaped unharmed. According to reports, more than 25 were killed and at least 29 wounded at the event. The attack took place when the head of the High Peace Council, Muhammad Karim Khalili, was giving a speech during the ceremony marking the anniversary of the death of Abdul Ali Mazari, leader of the Hezb-e-Wahdat party. According to reports, at least 18 were wounded at the event. Afghan President Ashraf Ghani later tweeted that the attack was a crime against humanity and against the national unity of Afghanistan. This is the first substantive attack on the capital since a troop withdrawal agreement was signed in Doha between the United States and the Taliban Islamist militant group. Taliban denied responsibility for the attack.
U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo has called a surge in violence in Afghanistan this week unacceptable and warned both the Taliban and the Afghan government to stop posturing ahead of intra-Afghan peace talks.
U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo has called the recent violence in Afghanistan unacceptable, but assured that the United States would continue to push the Afghan peace process forward. Pompeo, while briefing press at the State Department on Thursday, mentioned the need to discuss the disputed prisoner release clause in the February 29 agreement with the Taliban and said that Special Envoy Zalmay Khalilzad is in Kabul to move things along. Even as Pompeo criticized the increase in violence, he insisted senior Taliban leaders remain committed to their deal with the United States.
We know that the road ahead will be difficult. We expected it. We were right. The upsurge in violence in parts of Afghanistan over the last couple days is unacceptable. In no uncertain terms, violence must be reduced immediately for the peace process to move forward.
This comes as the Afghan government has rejected the provision in the U.S.-Taliban agreement that requires it to release up to 5,000 Taliban prisoners ahead of negotiations to reconcile the Taliban and the Afghan government. In exchange, the Taliban would release 1,000 Afghan government prisoners. The Taliban, in response, has resumed military operations against Afghan forces, to which the US on Wednesday also launched an airstrike against the Taliban fighters.
Moving on, a massive demonstration was held by activists against the genocide of Pashtuns in Pakistan during the ongoing UNHRC session in Geneva. They highlighted innocent Pashtuns have been targets of military operations, ethnic stereotyping and abductions by the Pakistani state and its security forces.
Pashtun activists held a massive demonstration against ongoing genocide of Pashtuns by the Pakistan Army in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa and federally administered tribal areas during the ongoing UNHRC session in Geneva. Holding banners and white and black flags symbolizing peace and denouncing terrorism, they raised anti-Pakistan slogans while seeking urgent UN intervention to save the Pashtun identity and their culture. The highlighted Pashtuns have been targets of military operations, ethnic stereotyping and abductions by the Pakistani state and its security forces.
Yes, but in the last 20 years, in the so-called war on terror, the way the Pakistani military has killed the Pashtuns in the tribal belt, it is unprecedented. So genocide of Pashtun not only physically is continuing, but they are killing our culture, our traditions and our language also.
Pashtun activists have long alleged that Pakistani army functions along with militant groups in federally administered tribal areas and indiscriminately use brute force against innocent Pashtuns. The activists, who gathered from parts of Europe and the US, also held a conference at a special tent in front of the UN building to highlight the situation. They also raised concerns over targeted killings of Pashtun political activists in Pakistan.
Shehnaz Kamal is the only female boxing coach in male-dominated sport in conservative Pakistan. But that hasn't stopped her making her mark. From breaking glass ceiling to making a name for herself, today Kamal is doing her best to nurture a younger generation of boxers.
Shehnaz Kamal is the only female boxing coach in male-dominated sport in conservative Pakistan, which clings tightly to traditional rules. With her mitts on, she trains young boys and girls boxing techniques and she's doing her best to nurture a younger generation of boxers. Despite traditional misgivings in Pakistan about women in boxing, Peshawar-born Kamal hasn't stopped from making her mark. She is the first and the only international female boxing coach registered with the Boxing Federation of Pakistan.
मुखालफत तो मेरी बहुत ज़्यादा जगहों पे हुई है इन लॉज ने भी की है फैमिली ने भी की है रिलेटिव्स जितने भी थे सब ने की है किसी ने साथ नहीं दिया सिवाय हस्बैंड के हस्बैंड ने साथ दिया लेकिन जब एक मकाम पे पहुंच गई नेशनल कोच के अलावा जब इंटरनेशनल हो गई तो फिर सारे वाह वाह करने लगे
ग्रोइंग अप इन अ फैमिली ऑफ बॉक्सर्स कमल स्पेंट हर चाइल्डहुड सीक्रेटली यर्निंग टू पुट ऑन ग्लव्स व्हेन हर हस्बैंड डिस्कवर्ड हर इंटरेस्ट ही स्टार्टेड कोचिंग हर breaking with social norms of Pathans, the ethnic group they belong to.
My daughter was born, then I thought that if there is no other one, then I will make my daughter a boxer. So for my daughter, I need a female coach. So I have made this decision for Pakistan. I mean, you understand that अब मैंने पठान माशरे को चीर पार के मैं आगे चला गया और अपनी वाइफ को उसमें ले आया बॉक्सिंग में.
Apart from training her children, she has trained some girls in the rooftop gym as there were no facilities for them to learn the sport. A few of the girls who were trained there have even gone on to win medals in the South Asian Games. To date, Kamal reckons she has trained around 600 male and 150 female boxers. She says there would be more if there were government support.
18 students were trained in bird watching in Dachigam National Park in India's Jammu and Kashmir so that they can get employment as bird guides and also promote tourism. The month-long program came to close on Thursday.
India's northern Jammu and Kashmir region is popularly known as the paradise on earth. It is world famous for its scenic splendor, snow-capped mountains and rich flora and fauna. A month-long program on bird identification and basic ornithology, organized by authorities to train the youth in order to promote bird watching as nature-based tourism, came to a close on Thursday. The participants during the training program were taught about bird identification, basics about ornithology, bird species, and their effects on environment. The aim of the training was to turn these students into guides for bird tourism so that they can promote tourism and create employment opportunities.
The basic purpose was that local bachche hai jo in wetlands ke around rehte hain jaki birds maximum aati hai unki skill development kare taki फ्यूचर में एज इको गाइड्स एज नेचर गाइड्स काम कर सके अपना रोजगार कमा सके और साथ साथ हमें जो वुलर कंजर्वेशन है या दूसरे वेटलैंड्स उनको कंजर्वेशन में मदद करें.
पार्टिसिपेंट्स एक्सप्रेस देयर एक्साइटमेंट ऑन द कंप्लीशन ऑफ द ट्रेनिंग आफ्टर दे वर हैंडेड सर्टिफिकेट्स.
तो जो हमें जिसमें हमें थियोरेटिकली और प्रैक्टिकली बहुत सारी चीज़ें सिखाई और बताई और दिखाई भी गई तो ओवरऑल मैं इतना कहूंगा कि प्रोग्राम बहुत ही ज़्यादा हेल्पफुल था और पहली बार हुआ था कश्मीर में.
The participants said initiatives like such will promote both bird conservation and tourism in Jammu and Kashmir.
Festivities with full fervor have begun in parts of India's northern Uttar Pradesh province as people mark the beginning of Holi, the festival of colors. As part of the annual celebrations, scores of Hindu devotees on Friday smeared each other with ashes of cremated dead people in spiritual city of Varanasi, upholding a centuries-old tradition.
Devout Hindus on Friday celebrated Holi, the festival of colors, by smearing each other with ashes of cremated dead people in India's spiritual town of Varanasi, upholding a centuries-old tradition. Scores of people gathered at the banks of River Ganges and greeted each other with ashes and danced to the tunes of traditional songs. According to a legend, Hindu god of destruction Shiva had come to take his wife Parvati home after a couple of days of marriage on the occasion of Rangbhari Ekadashi. But his dear gang of ghosts, goblins and ghouls who are not allowed to come where humans are residing missed the celebrations. So, it is believed Shiva comes back to celebrate with the ghost every year on this occasion, giving birth to the tradition.
ये बनारस की बहुत ही पुरानी परंपरा है. इस परंपरा को बनारस के लोग आज भी जिंदा रखे हैं. इसलिए हम बनारसियों को बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद देते हैं और हम बहुत ही भाग्यशाली है कि इसमें शामिल होने का हमें अवसर मिलता है.
Devotees in Varanasi on Thursday also celebrated the occasion of Rangbhari Ekadashi by smearing each other in colors and dancing to the beats of traditional instruments, carrying idols of Lord Shiva and Goddess Parvati. Holi, which is also known as the Indian Festival of Spring or the Festival of Love, is marked in different forms across India and people start celebrating it prior to the actual date. The festival falls on March 10 this year.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/sasianewsline and follow us on Twitter @sasianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time next week. Have a great weekend. Good night.